Hello and welcome to this installment of our RSAC 365 virtual seminar. I'm Casey Zirkus, Senior Content Manager with RSA Conference, and today's half-day seminar is exploring supply chain security. Based on the conversations we've had, we know that organizations large and small are struggling to address the challenges of risk from their downline partners and vendors. And our goal today is to help each of you not only understand why establishing trust is critical to managing risk, but also to help you identify the ways that attackers can leverage vulnerabilities in the software supply chain so that you can better respond to those threats. Our chair for this event and today's panel moderator is Shamla, Naidoo. But before I turn it over to Shamla, please note that during the seminar, all participants will be in listen-only mode. We will have time set aside for Q&A after the panel, and then again after the sessions from Joseph, Felix, and Jen. If you do have a question, please submit it during and throughout the seminar in the Q&A feature on the right of your screen. As a reminder, this seminar is being recorded, and following the seminar, you'll receive an email containing the link to the video replay. The replay will also be posted at rsaconference.com. And I want to remind you that as part of RSAC's 365 Cybersecurity Learning Program, we accept submissions on any topic year-round. You too can contribute your expertise on a seminar, webcast, podcast, or blog by visiting rsaconference.com/become-a-contributor. Finally, just a note that after the panel, we'll take a quick break and come right back for the sessions from Joseph, Felix, and Jen. I'd now like to turn it over to Shamla to introduce herself and dive right in.
That sounds great. Thank you, Casey, and thank you everyone for joining this webinar. We're really excited. We got a great lineup of both topics and fantastic speakers for the rest of this seminar. So hopefully at the end of 4 hours, you're going to go away with a ton of very, very valuable information. So just to kind of think about the day. So we're going to have an opening keynote panel with some fantastic speakers. Then we're going to go to have, you know, three different topics we're going to talk. The idea on the talks is to give you specific and actionable information that you can actually go back and use. So this is not just a, you know, a theoretical conversation. We want to make it really practical. So you're going to hear from speakers and we'll kind of talk about those as we go along, both how we deal with attackers, how we protect our organizations, and how we kind of can control what happens in our ecosystem. With that, let me go directly to this opening panel. The opening panel is about establishing trust to enhance supply chain security. But before we actually talk about trust, let's talk about what supply chain security is. You know, it's the management of risk for external suppliers, vendors, logistics, and transportation, everything that goes into getting you something that you're going to use and integrate into your business. During the pandemic, we saw supply chain disruptions coming in all shapes and forms. Some of it, you know, became the shortage of toilet paper to the shortage of cars. And, you know, that was in short supply, but our ecosystem of supply chain came to a near standstill. Remember when all the containers were stuck in the ports, et cetera. And so the question we really have to wrestle with is, did anyone identify those risks in those supply chains, whether it was the toilet paper or the cars? Did they identify those risks in order to mitigate them in advance? And so similarly, you know, when you think about what we do every day, there have been a few very high-profile incidents specifically related to the software supply chain. And so, you know, what we want to do is think about how we're going to react to that. Everything from, you know, Equifax to SolarWinds to Okta to GitHub, you name it, and someone has been in the news. And we can always tie that back to someone didn't do something they should have done or someone did something they shouldn't have done. And in that supply chain, you're going to have a number of actors. We now need to figure out how do we proactively identify them and start to figure out what we do about them. So we're going to dig really deep into this topic right now. I have a fantastic set of speakers, seasoned security leaders, practitioners who have lived this every day. And, you know, they have such impressive backgrounds and so much personal accomplishments. And so with that, I'd like to call, you know, my friends, Joanna, Kris, and Rinki. What I want to do is have each of them just, we're going to get right to the topics, but I do want them to talk a little bit about themselves, the companies they represent, what they do. And so, you know, as you kind of do your introduction, tell us about why this software supply chain is important to you and your companies. With that, let me turn over my screen. I'll go straight to Joanna, and then Rinki, and then Kris.
Thank you, Shamla. Welcome, everybody. Really happy to join you all today, and I'm looking forward to the conversation. I am Joanna Burkey. I'm the Global CISO for HP Inc. And my interest, of course, in the supply chain is that HP, like many of us, are right in the middle of it. Upstream from us in this supply chain, we consume both physical and digital products from a variety of suppliers. We rely on suppliers and partners to do logistics for us, to buy software from. We use open source software, you know, pretty much you name it. A company of my size is going to consume it. Then we, of course, are in the middle of that chain. And then downstream from us, we are offering products and services to customers and consumers. So they are using both the things we build and they're using the frameworks that we pay other partners and suppliers for to deliver those frameworks, both the physical and the non-physical ones. So, you know, this is a very broad envelope, but I think it's also very representative of a lot of our companies right now.
Thank you, Joanna. I'll turn it over to Rinki.
Hi, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here. I'm Rinki Sethi. I am the VP and CISO at Bill, where I lead information security and IT. I've been in the cybersecurity space for 2 decades. I've worked with for companies like Twitter, Rubrik, IBM, actually with Shamla, and many other companies here in the Bay Area. Talking about supply chain, we've heard about a lot of recent breaches around it. And so obviously for many of the reasons that Shamla, you covered, supply chain is just such a critical area and is also heavily regulated for many of us. In addition to that, I think we've seen too, kind of the impact of not considering some of these third parties that you're relying on as very critical to your business and ensuring that you have things like business continuity baked in and thought of. So I'm really excited to be on this panel and chat more with all of you about this topic.
Kris?
Hi, and Shamla, thank you so much for having me. And thank you everyone for joining us today. So I'm Kris Lovejoy. I am with a company called Kyndryl. For those of you who don't know what a Kyndryl is, we are the other half of IBM. So IBM split into essentially two parts about a year and a half ago. I am with the services the services group. We are a fully independent company of about 90,000 people, so pretty much the biggest startup in the world. And what we're all about is building and managing mission-critical systems on behalf of our customers. Now, my role within Kyndryl is really twofold. One is I am running the security and resiliency business, and second, I am responsible for looking after commercial security. So that's ensuring that we are adhering to the policies, contracts, et cetera, that we put in place with our customers vis-a-vis security and resiliency. Now, one thing that is important to me is, you know, we are, you know, on the resiliency side, we are the biggest provider today of kind of recovery for customers. And you know, one of the things that I'm seeing worldwide is that, you know, any given day, about 50% of all of the outages we're seeing in our customer environments are related to hardware and software failures. And when you do a root cause analysis, it is very hard to figure out exactly what it's all about. And in fact, about 50% of those cases, we don't ever find an answer. And so there's a lot of fragility associated with the supply chain, both what we are ingesting and running ourselves, as well as what we're procuring and offering to our customers. So it's a very complex situation and dynamic. And I'm actually really happy about learning more from all of you today.
Fantastic. So for your audience, you can see what we have here is a powerhouse panel. But what you're hearing, I think, underneath the conversations that we just had for introductions is that these big companies have both the ability to consume products and services from others, as well as deliver products and services to their customers. And so, you know, the companies here are right in the middle of the supply chain issue. And so, you know, I want to talk a little bit about trust. We saw that, you know, third parties in our ecosystem are so important, right? If it doesn't work and everyone doesn't play their part, the toilet paper doesn't get to the shelf as it's supposed to. But at the same time, you know, we don't trust. In security, there's very little trust. On the supply chain side, it's exacerbated because it's not just that you don't trust, it's that you don't have the ability to control what you do when you don't trust, right? So what I want to do is I want to turn over to this panel. I want to have this conversation about trust. You know, what's the level of trust you have with your suppliers today? And want to talk, you know, purely about the supplier side before we talk about what you do as a supplier. But what's the level of trust? What's that relationship like? Tell us more.
So Shamla, I'm happy to start and throw it out there, and I'd love to hear what my friends and peers on the panel have to say. I will describe the approach that we currently take at HP, and I'm going to caveat it and say it's always changing and we're always listening for ways to do it differently. I don't necessarily think that the way most of us at companies are handling the trust and validation topic right now is sustainable to go into the future, honestly. There, you know, our current approach is very similar to a lot of enterprises where we group any third party that we work with into a tier based on the risk that we have. And that risk can come from a variety of ways. You know, how critical is the service they're performing for us? What's the sensitivity of the data that they might control? What are the interconnect mitigations we might be able to put in place? And then based on those tiers, we expect a certain level of insight into their security program, into their ISMS or their IPSS. We expect certain attestations depending on the tier that they're in. And really depending on those conversations and the attestations and the contractual commitments from both parties, both HP and the one we're working with, that really determines our level of trust and comfort working with that party. It works okay, you know, but the part in there that I feel like is going to adapt as we go into the future is you cannot document everything in a contract. And if you try, it's untenable. So I really see a future where we're going to become less bound to specificity in contracts and more centered around both parties committing to do their best within certain guardrails, but then both parties implementing pragmatic technical zero trust from a technical basis, not necessarily from a contractual or a relationship basis.
Great. Anyone else want to weigh in and add? I'm sure there's just tons of information here.
Yeah, I'll chime in here. So, I mean, I think everything that was described. And in addition, I think many enterprises follow the same process here. I think it's also important, in addition to partnering with trusted vendors, because many of us are also suppliers. It's even more critical. And, you know, Bill, we serve our small and medium businesses. And so I think it's also important to bake into your business, depending on the criticality of the service or what kind of data you're collecting, ensuring that you've got good continuity, good recovery practices as well, that you're, if you have a vendor that's so critical to your business or a supplier that's so critical to your business, that do you have a backup that's identified if that business is hit by some kind of security incident? And if they go down, are you ensuring that you've done everything for your customers? And I think we've seen time and time again when that hasn't been considered because you base your trust on relationship and some of these attestations that when something does happen, you're kind of caught without a backup plan. And so I think it's very, very important that yes, trust, also verify, but then also have a recovery and backup plan.
Yeah. Can I add just one last thing? And I wanted to echo what both Joanna and Rinki have said. You know, there's a fundamental principle of risk management, which is if you can't measure it, you can't improve it. And today, when it comes to supply chain management, the way in which we effectively measure our sort of the supply chain relationship is within the context, as Joanna was describing, the T's and C's that we have in place with the vendors. And we measure compliance, non-compliance with that. That's not a realistic way of looking at really effectively measuring trust. That's number one. number two, so let's park that aside and say the approach that we take is not necessarily the right approach. You need to be more proactive in engaging and understanding technical controls. But there's a second aspect to this, which Rinki was sort of talking about, which is the criticality of the vendor. I think the other issue we have today is that we have the way in which we look at the criticality of a vendor is kind of off. Oftentimes what I see, it's the two guys in a garage who are writing SAP modules for the business are the most critical suppliers to the business, right? Meanwhile, your most critical vendor is the one with whom you have the biggest financial relationship. That's misplaced. You have to think, you really, really have to think about the criticality of the vendor within the context of the, what is it that they are producing and the significance to which that particular asset you're depending on it. And it's, we've got to change that as well.
That's fantastic. And, Joanna and Rinki, if you want to add anything to it, please do, because this is the foundation, right? How important are they? And are we treating them with the level of importance that they are in our companies?
It made me, listening to Kris just now, reminded me of that cartoon that we've all seen. I think it was an XKCD cartoon where you have this huge, amazing machinery and it's held up by a tiny little stick in the corner that's being managed by two people in Mississippi, right? I think there is a lot to unpack here with what Kris said around how do we determine criticality. And an analogy that I would give is how we as CISOs think about our critical systems in a company. You know, it's often really tempting when you go, what's your most critical system? People go, oh, ERP, right? Because it is so important to closing the books, to meeting customer commitments. But guess what? If AD goes down, your books don't matter, right? So we've seen this. We've realized it through hard experience the last few years. I think we're starting to realize through hard experience that the way we determine criticality of suppliers might be a little bit off as well. And I think that's something that really needs intentionality and thought.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. And we'll continue to dig in. And if you have other, you know, thoughts you want to add, just feel free to do that. But, you know, so we talk about the level of trust. Rinki, you know, in your organization, like you said, you're serving small and medium businesses. So they may not have the maturity or they may not have the knowledge or the skills to kind of get their security programs to a point where they need to. So when you become a critical supplier to them, share with us, like, how do you handle this? Like, so there's a, how do you handle this as a supplier, but then how do you handle this as a consumer? And are they consistent? What do you expect from your suppliers? Is that what you give to your customers as well?
Yeah, I think absolutely. It's a two-way expectation, right? Of course, we have these expectations from our vendors and our suppliers, and of course our small and medium businesses, sometimes they know what questions to ask, sometimes they don't, right? And if, and they just assume that if I go with Bill, that it's going to be a trusted, they're going to be a trusted partner and we're going to be protected. And so this is extremely important to us, and that trust element can't be breached. And so some of the areas, I think when I think about third party risk, I feel like there's a few things that you have to consider in building out that program and how you manage your third parties. Whether it's, looking at what the small businesses or medium businesses should be looking at or what we look at. And so a couple of things is ensuring that you have some kind of framework and defined process for assessing risk with your third parties. That includes having kind of a data map to include all your third-party vendors and making sure that you're updating that data map and there's some kind of automation, right, associated with that. So as the data that you collect from the vendors changes or as your suppliers may change and the partnership may change, that you're making sure that data map is updated and that all the threat models and risk models you've built around this supplier is updated. And then ensuring that whatever you're doing is based on kind of the standards in the industry that you're working on and that you're using some kind of industry standard to build that framework off of. And I think then thinking beyond just that supplier is also kind of what we discussed earlier, that looking at the onboarding and the offboarding, and it's not just about that supplier economy that may be sitting in your ecosystem, but it's more about like, are you managing the onboarding and the offboarding? Are you ensuring that that data that is protected in the right way as you change suppliers, and kind of taking a look at that whole life cycle? And then what I mentioned, which is kind of outside, not particularly in the scope of a third party risk program with suppliers, making sure that all the business continuity plans and everything around that, that you're looking at your business holistically, and that includes looking at your third parties that you may be leveraging. And so that's kind of how, that's just part of the process that we follow around third parties and managing third parties. And then of course, we do the same being a supplier as well. And then of course, being in the fintech space, all the regulatory requirements, ensuring that we're meeting those and we're providing our customers with those attestations as well.
Great. You know, Joanna and Kris, you come from like giant companies where you kind of serving and supporting the world's largest corporations. Is it different for you? Just in terms of, you know, the size and the scale. And
I think the principles that Rinki describes are really similar. I think there's a lot of core principles here that make sense no matter what scale is that we're talking about. And I think scale is a really interesting question because, you know, yes, you know, Kyndryl and HP, massive companies, but if you look at our upstream supply chain, I guarantee you're going to find some SMBs in there, right? And, you know, that is something that I think needs a huge amount of attention, which is, you know, I think maybe it's tempting to think if you're at a large enterprise and you're serving other large enterprises, that everyone has similar budgets and everyone has similar programs. And I don't think that holds up when you really start to look at the entire prime and subprime chain. And I think that is something that's really important. I'm starting to see it talked about a lot more these days. I think we've all realized that we have these dependencies, and we're also realizing there's not a lot of easy answers to it either. This morning, I noticed something really interesting. This morning in Wired, there was an article that I think it's the University of Texas at Austin has stood up a free advisory program for SMBs of a certain size, where they can come to the university to get free advice about what they do. And it's exactly those same principles Rinki described. And those are the same principles that we follow at my, you know, 66,000 person company as well. So there's a lot of commonality here. And I think that's a good thing, because those common principles can, I think, be the foundation for us to start to take a more consistent approach to this.
Yeah. I want to tackle this from a little bit of a different vantage point, because what I think is, I agree with everything that's been said. I just think it's important to understand, you know, a couple of things. I mean, first and foremost, so, you know, during the COVID period, talk about this a lot, you know, we were walking into a situation where there had been a lot of digital innovation through the years, a lot of it on cloud, where we just took work, you know, legacy workloads, put it on cloud, and then all of a sudden discovered it's really complex and hard to manage. Then you have COVID, and all of a sudden 60% of the world is introducing new technology. And of that, 60% did not actually secure the technology that they were putting out. So you've got a situation where the attack surface has increased absolutely dramatically. And we are all digesting technology in lots of different ways from third-party vendors in ways that we're really not thinking about it. And a lot of the technology that we are digesting today has not been adequately secured. Now, whether you're small, whether you're big, it's all the same. It's the same. I think the question is the scope. One of the things that I really think is important, though, is as we are really considering the way forward, we must recognize the interdependency between the supply chain partners, the technology providers who are providing us stuff, and the what we do as a business. It is inextricable. And oftentimes we talk about supply chain as if it's a separate thing. It's not a separate thing. It's part of the business. And so what we have to be able to do is understand what is it that makes the business run. What are the third-party components? What are the components we are digesting that are part of the thing that we're building, et cetera, et cetera? Rip that apart and figure out how to actually control each of the elements. But we can't think about supply chain as being a different thing from the business impact analysis, risk management processes that we're implementing within our businesses, because otherwise we're going to be in big trouble. Now, from an SMB perspective, one of the good news things is SMBs, in a way, they're procuring an integrated service. Now, the mistake they're making is they're assuming that the seatbelts are in the car that they're procuring. We know that doesn't happen. However, the scope is a little bit less complex for them. So I think that the benefit is, if you are a small party and you're procuring these services, if you ask the right questions and you configure the right things, you can get to a better answer than some of the larger organizations.
For sure, for sure. So let's talk about that, right? So Joanna, let me start with you. So what skills and investments are needed from companies like yours or Rinki's or, you know, Kris's, to actually wrestle this problem to the ground? Because you've got this problem on two fronts. You've got, you know, the I provide the service, I need to provide this level of service, to I consume the service, this is what I expect. What are the skills and investments that are needed?
One of the first ones that I think is really continuing to emerge as a priority, and it's not always been obvious in a field where most of us started as technologists, it's the skill and the ability to understand the right balance of allowing the business with the appropriate guardrails. You know, especially I think when we're engaging with third parties and we're engaging with partners and suppliers, there's so much this desire to break it all down to the black and white because that makes it easy. You can say, oh, they checked all the boxes, ergo we're good. They didn't check all the boxes, ergo we're bad. And, you know, that would be nice if it was that easy, but that's why we know compliance doesn't equal security, right? So one of the biggest needs I see, and I think cyber programs are still struggling to synthesize this, is the ability to make the decision that's appropriate based on the outcomes you need and what the business really needs. And that's a tough thing because you're asking people to make what's, you know, I'm not going to call it a gut call, but, you know, it does the same way that a business leader makes decisions on how to run their business, or a CFO makes decisions on what amount of currency risk are they comfortable with. We need the people in our organization to be able to make those same calls on what's going to be the best thing for the business. That balance between protecting the business for the long term and making sure that you're running a sustainable business into the future, but making sure that you're not putting so many constraints on it up front that you can't even get going and get into that future. So that's one skill set that I really see that we need, is that continued, you know, acumen to understand that there's different answers in different areas. And frankly, I could go on and on with skill sets, but that is the biggest one that comes to my mind.
And Kris, you pointed out a couple. Want to add anything to that?
So I thought that was a great answer. I don't know how I could add more. I think Joanna was right on point. This is such a tricky, I think we're in the beginning stages of a pretty radical change in how we're thinking about cyber more generally. And one of the things I just want to mention is, as we're thinking about this, we shouldn't be thinking about security in a silo. Mm-hmm. At the end of the day, you know, if you're talking about a management or a supervisory board, what they care about is whether the business service is up and running. You know, yes, it's important to me to understand why something went down, but they care about it being up and running and available. And so one of the mistakes we make is we get so deep in talking about security versus something else. And I think that, you know, when we're talking about supply chain partners, it's not just security that's an issue. It's about how they maintain their data. They could be secure, but just have very, really bad practices vis-a-vis data maintenance. They might have, you know, there might be flaws, coding flaws. There might be other issues. They're using technology as GPL that's going to be restricted. They may have, you know, sort of data localization, data sovereignty. There might be lots of restrictions. We've got to think about the vendor and the risk that they pose from a cyber perspective, not necessarily a security perspective. And I think that's one of the things we keep getting stuck on as well, is we're getting down the security rat hole when it needs to be a broader discussion.
And yeah. I would add I would add on to that to say, we've got to think about the overall ability for our partners and suppliers to stay operational as a whole. Mm-hmm. I love looking back. I hate that it happened, but I love looking at what happened with Southwest Airlines over the holiday, because that showed mm-hmm. that you can have massive operational disruption to a company, not because of a cyber breach. So, you know, I couldn't agree more with Kris here. I think we need to look broadly at digital risk, and cyber is a huge piece of that. But the handling of data, the operational resilience, the hardware and software lifecycle management of the systems that we depend on, those are all pieces of that digital risk envelope, and they can all have an equally impactful effect on what we do.
Yep. So Rinki, just a quick thought from you. So, you know, leading a program like this at a fintech, I mean, can companies afford all this that we're doing? And Joanna talked about it not being scalable and maybe not being sustainable over time. You know, can companies afford what is required to make this actually work?
I think it requires a lot of investment in the business, right? And it's not just the security team running this third-party risk program in a silo, which Kris and Joanna talked about too. It's not looking at it just from a supplier security risk. It's getting the business involved, right? And having them understand kind of what the criticality is to the business, what could happen if this service goes down again to the business, right? And then what are the cybersecurity aspects to it? And I think it's the investments come from like that care from the executive team, from the board. And we talked a little bit about kind of management and board and what they care about. And that's a really good question to ask too, is the board asking the right questions? Is the management team asking the right questions as it relates to the business? Because cybersecurity for most companies is the number one risk. And a lot of that includes the suppliers you're partnering with. So I think it's really important. And so going back to your question on, is this sustainable? I think it's really hard for small and medium businesses. That's why we as suppliers have to do the best job that we can to ensure that security is top of mind and that we're building our services with security in mind and that we're really taking care of the data. And then on the flip side, as we're reviewing our suppliers, I think really engaging the business on that, ensuring it's tied really closely into a procurement process, legal process, and the business is heavily involved in that. And I think in that scenario, you can scale the program. I do think there's some challenges, you know, for heavily regulated industries where you're, you know, and of course, for even from a customer or partner standpoint, where product companies are just being hammered with questionnaires and things like that. And there needs to be some kind of standardization on how we do this. But I do think that, you know, you can scale it.
Yeah. Yes, absolutely. So thank you for sharing that. I just want to go to the audience and just remind you all that we do have a segment dedicated for Q&A. There are a number of questions coming in. I would encourage you to put your questions into the Q&A. And when we get to that segment, we will try to answer as many of them as we can. And if I can incorporate them into this discussion, I will do that as well. So there is a question about regulatory guidance. Let me just jump right into that question, which is, you know, let's talk more broadly about regulations. What is the existing regulatory framework to guide the industry on this topic today? And just, you know, share your thoughts, share your expertise on this regulatory topic around third-party risk and management.
Who wants to go first?
I start. Anyone?
You know, I was part of a really interesting roundtable. It was probably right over a year ago. There was a group of CISOs got together intentionally from really different industry verticals to talk about, is there a way to sort of develop a middle of the road position to advise Capitol Hill in the U.S. on how to structure the regulations that they were working on at the time. This was like around the Portman-Peters bill, et cetera. And, you know, you can definitely find practitioners out in the industry that are like, no regulation, no way, no how, leave us alone. And you can find people that say, bring it on, the more regulation, the better. I think most of us are in this middle ground where we realize that some regulation is a good thing. It is not only inevitable, So, you know, you got to figure out how to live with it, but it can also help greatly. I mean, how much has the NIST CSF framework helped us in developing our programs, right? I feel, though, that we're almost in this odd place where we either have too many regulations or we don't have enough. Because it's sort of like you can go find the regulation du jour or the framework du jour that you like, but I don't know that we have enough commonality. And so, especially for large companies that are consuming similar products from a variety of suppliers, it's not so easy to say, hey, why don't all of y'all just stick with this framework? You know, all of you use this one and then we can all be in good shape. So sort of like what PCI DSS has been for the financial industry, I feel like we're still somewhat in need of something like that in cyber.
And I would say, I think the word of the day is balkanization, fragmentation of regulation. There, so, you know, as Joanna was indicating, there is no single set of standards out there to which a particular organization can adhere. It is not only jurisdiction by jurisdiction or region by region, it's country by country. And oftentimes, like in the United States, it's not country by country, it's sector by sector. And even within the context of the sector, like the financial institutions, it really is dependent on the size of the organization, how those requirements manifest themselves. Now, there is has been some attempt at kind of international reconciliation, and I think the administration has done a very good job of having discussions with like-minded partners on this particular subject. As Joanna is describing, this is in discussion mode. It's not necessarily manifesting itself in anything that is real. You know, what we are seeing, like in Europe, for instance, is, you know, there's discussion as part of DORA, the Resiliency Act, that there is going to be some, you know, new requirements in and around supply chain security. What those look like, we don't know. In the US, we've got CMMC. CMMC looks like it is going to be reconciled with 800-171, the NIST standard. So there's a lot of stuff happening, right? But there is no set of frameworks, no standards, no regulations today outside of perhaps CMMC 800-171. If you kind of push those together, there's really nothing today that you can go on.
So there's a question in the chat, and maybe we can talk about this. Someone asked if we've seen the guidance published by the FDIC, the Federal Reserve, and the OCC. Now, I imagine that will apply to financial services, but is there something there we can use and leverage? Or is that too restrictive for most organizations if they're not financial services?
I think, Shamla, it's useful, obviously, for the financial services industry. And, you know, because we provide services to most financial services companies, we are considered to be kind of in scope, so very familiar with the requirements. I would say this, though, is the end of the day, because there is no significant guidance, you have to implement a common sense approach that works for your business. I know that sounds really trite, but you know, you have to understand, how does your business work? How do you develop technology? How do you procure software? And you really think about it from your perspective. What does it mean? And what kind of outcomes do you want? There is no one size fits all here that can be applied.
I think there is a lot to what Kris said about, you know, I feel like from current state to just having a floor of common sense, there's still a ways to go in there. So in a way, you know, I feel like it's a little bit of a champagne problem to think about, oh, well, let's all unite around one thing. I think there's still a really big gap between status quo and just having that first layer of common sense. Now, I do think, and Shamla, you brought this up a while ago, and Rinki, you did too, there is a cybersecurity poverty line problem in there. You know, it's one thing to look at Fortune 500 companies and say, just do what makes sense, all right, get over it. But then to look at the really small companies and realize, you know, we tell everyone, you know, let's look at the CISO guidance. It says roll out MFA. Great guidance. Cannot argue with it. How expensive, if you are a 100-person corporation, is it to roll out MFA? So that still, to me, I would really like to be focusing on that and raise the floor a little bit before we focus too much on what is the ceiling.
And I think on this, by the way, on the ceiling, and I don't know if anybody's been paying to the national security strategy, but liability is going downhill, right? So what's going to happen is, you know, the incentive program that's being discussed, that's a euphemistic way of describing an incentive. Incentive means legislation and liability, and it's coming right at us, as well as anybody who's providing digital services to anybody else. We got to think about this. And I think, you know, Joanna, to your point, it's like, let's just focus on the basics right now, because we all know stuff like patching and MFA. Got to get it done.
Yeah. And I, you know, Kris, I was having the conversation the other day, and I'm actually going to be talking with our internal software council about this afternoon. We're seeing echoes of the Ralph Nader situation right now, of the late 70s and the early 80s. For anybody out there who's old enough to remember, and this is white hair, by the way, it's not dyed blonde. I remember, you know, Ralph Nader and this grassroots push around forcing corporations to make things that were safe for consumers came up because corporations weren't, you know, and the US government finally noticed, gosh, there's a lot of revenue out there that we're missing out on that we could get a piece of. And that really led to the Consumer Safety Commission and all of the things that are done now around consumer safety. I think we are seeing that exact thing play out now with security liability. And we should expect it to go the same direction.
100% agree.
So let's just talk a little bit about this. And Kris, you kind of mentioned it earlier, but you know, when you're in the boardroom, and a number of you, if not all of you, are on boards of some sort, and you know, you have this conversation. One thing that boards understand is resilience of the business. So let's start with, you know, Kris, what does resilience in the supply chain mean for you, for Kyndryl, for your customers? And then I'd love to hear from Rinki and Joanna as well. You know, this idea of resilience has suddenly made this problem tangible.
Yeah, I think that cyber resilience, you know, it is becoming a buzzword, which is unfortunate, but it's an important concept. I think it is kind of the digital risk management that we're talking about, cyber risk management, whatever you want to call it. The aperture is any and all cyber-related events that can impact business availability, business performance are within scope of cyber resilience. And the way cyber resilience is being defined, that's really coming largely out of the financial sector as well as Europe, is the ability to anticipate, basically see around corners and understand the threats, understand the risks, to be able to protect against through controls like we've been doing, to be able to withstand, meaning detect and respond, as well as to be able to recover from any and all cyber-related events, again, affecting the business. So resilience is a pretty broad aperture. Now, when it comes to supply chain, within that context, the question is, how do supply chain partners factor within the business resilience? So if there is a dependency on that supply chain partner for the procurement of technology upon which the business service is dependent, or any other dependency, from a critical nature, how does one anticipate that there's going to be a problem with them, protect them or protect yourself against them? How do you detect and ensure that when something goes wrong, you're able to replace and then recover when those particular supply chain partners fail? So again, when you're thinking about it from a systems perspective, cyber resilience is this broad aperture, including but not limited to cybersecurity, and is going to incorporate supply chain within that context.
Right. Rinki, you want to weigh in? Joanna?
I agree with everything that Kris just mentioned. Nothing to add on top of that.
I would add one thing, which I think is, it's a really good thing for us trying to articulate cyber risk to the board, that they are very familiar with the topic of supply chain resilience overall. You know, I was actually having conversation with one of HP's board members recently, and I have had the same conversation with the companies of the boards on whom I sit, which is we can draw a lot of parallels to make this situation understandable, because for decades there's been risk in the supply chain, right? This is just risk in a slightly different way. So it's a great opportunity for us to, quote, speak that business language. And I think it's a great chance for us as CISOs and practitioners to practice phrasing what we do in a way that uses only business terms and doesn't go off and use these obscure cyber terms that people struggle with, but we can articulate it as exactly what it is, which is how do you increase your operational resilience? And you can have a really good conversation around that. Because again, some of the things that have already been done in other spaces, you know, for years in cyber, we've known that we can steal from the efforts that were done around physical safety. I mean, awareness and training, that started with physical safety back in the 60s, right? So there's a lot of concepts from there that we steal for our programs. There's a lot of concepts out there already, I think, that we can continue to leverage for our own type of resilience that we need in the supply chain.
Yep.
Hey, Shamla, can I ask a quick question of this, and of you and Joanna and Rinki? You know, so I'm beginning to get worried that the ability for us as CISOs to impact change in and around supply chain sort of improvement is somewhat limited. And so, you know, as I've been sort of thinking about the evolution of the role of the CISO and, you know, sort of what's next on the horizon, I'm wondering if kind of a redefinition of the roles and responsibilities of the CISO has to be created so that we can have a positive impact on operational resilience within a cyber context. And so I was just wondering, you know, what's your opinion on that? Because I just worry that, you know, the aperture for around what is a CISO is too narrow today, and it's got to be broadened if we have any hope of addressing this issue.
I couldn't agree more, Kris. I think that, you know, rather than the CISO's agenda becoming kind of the dumping ground for everything that's too nebulous and too difficult for others, they just kind of dump it on the CISO agenda and it becomes a risk topic. I feel like it has to be a little bit more well-defined. You know, every other C-suite role in corporations are pretty well-defined. In our area, it's, you know, a little bit of this and a little bit of that. Sometimes you own it. Sometimes it ends up in an enterprise risk function. Sometimes it ends up in a business continuity function. So it's all over the place. And so I think you're right. There probably needs to be some more clarity and definition of the role and the mission. And if the mission expands into risk, then we have a better opportunity of fixing these strategic risk items that usually just make it, because, you know, I mean, the cyber agenda, the cyber risk is one item on a long list of risk items. And so just purely by scale, it doesn't get the level of attention it ought to. Now, if we were sitting there with the whole risk agenda or the, you know, we owned it, the risk mission, we might make this the number one risk or the number two risk. And so I feel like we need to push for a little bit more standardization in the mission and the job description of the CISO. But I'll let others weigh in.
Yeah, I agree. And you know, it's not just expanding the scope of the, I think a lot of times the business doesn't understand, right, that resiliency is a different type of skill set. It's a different type of investment you need to make. It's a different care for the business. It's not the same as the cyber risk. And so it's not just expanding the scope and the definition of the role of a CISO and defining it better, but it's ensuring you're actually making the investments. It's not just, this is an added responsibility, but we're not going to add any investments. And then your business continuity plan or recovery plan is a document that sits there. Mm-hmm. And you do these tabletop exercises and then you check the box. It's got to be above and beyond that are we resourced properly? Are we looking at the plan all the way up to the board level, right? And so, you know, even in some of these board sessions that talks that I've done, it's a topic that comes up that, yes, you're talking about cybersecurity, but is resiliency and business continuity being talked about? That if you did have a breach, what's the continuity plan? What's the recovery plan? And many times it's not. So I think that's a change that needs to happen, that are we doing breach simulations? Are we doing these kind of simulations at the very senior most levels to understand where your gaps are so you can go drive the right investments, you know, whether that sits in the CISO responsibility or elsewhere?
I would like to throw out an alternative way to look at this. And I don't think there's a right or wrong answer. And I don't disagree with what y'all said about clarifying the scope of the CISO. I do, sometimes when I think about the fact that, you know, ultimately, if you wanted to put everything in the CISO scope that's adjacent to cyber, we would be the CEO. So what's a different way to look at this? Because I don't want to be a CEO. I don't know about y'all. Y'all may want to. It might be even a harder job than what we do already, right? So I think it's really important to get crisp about accountability here versus, you know, bringing visibility to something. It's our job to bring visibility to cyber risk. I do not believe at all that it is our job to be accountable for every little bit of cyber risk. And that's where I think enterprises fall down on, is not really being clear about that. Maybe even more than not being clear about the role.
So one thing I would add is, you know, Lorraine asked the question in the Q&A, what are some ideas on how to get the attention of leadership on the importance of this third-party risk problem? You know, and you all do this every day and probably have great ideas. But the one thing I would ask, and I think you kind of alluded to this, Kris, is, you know, in our tabletop exercises on resilience planning, have we turned off the connection to a critical third party and said, they no longer exist? And what will you do with your business at that point? Is that one way? It's a little radical, and you know, but is that a way to get their attention on the real impact? Because again, like I said earlier, resilience is the one thing that's tangible.
It is the best way. It's not just the one way. It is the best way to get C-suite or supervisory board attention on the subject of third-party risk, is to do tabletop exercises and include some sort of subversion of the supply chain partner, failure of the supply chain partner, prolonged outage of the supply chain partner, something along those lines. Absolutely is exactly what gets their attention.
Okay, great. So Lorraine and others who are listening, make sure to add this to your tabletop exercises and planning. I want to shift gears a little bit to the software supply chain, right? And there's one concept that has been bothering me for a while, and I hope that all you smart people can actually help me get off the ledge. So we keep talking about the software bill of materials. And, you know, and now there's all kinds of other evolutions of this bill of materials. And so I want to get a sense from all of you on your views on both the value and the effectiveness. And then I do want to share kind of my concern about this. And I think we got a great group here because, you know, a number of us are creating the platforms that others are consuming. And then all of you are, you know, providing your software to others. If you gave them a bill of materials, tell me what you think the value and the effectiveness of this is.
Yeah, I mean, I think that, you know, of course, the purpose and the context in which it's used is super important. And there are ways that the software bill of materials can be effective. Like you think about vulnerability management and how it can be used effectively to identify and track vulnerabilities, or you talk about supply chain risk management and, you know, how do you provide visibility into the components that are used in software development? You talk about patch management and how are you using that to quickly identify the components that need to be patched? And then of course, compliance and licensing. But I also think it relies on the accuracy and the completeness of the information that's provided and ensuring that it's properly maintained. And I think that's where you start looking at your software bill of materials and is it properly being maintained? Is it actually then providing effectiveness? If you are, then yes. Otherwise, not so much.
I look at it really similarly to a CMDB in both value and challenges. You know, a CMDB is an indispensable tool for a CISO so that our teams can track down system ownership. Or, you know, who do we go to when there's an issue? Or, hey, we heard about a zero day. Who do we need to go work with? In the same way, an SBOM would be an amazing tool for us, especially as more and more open source software is being used. And we have to struggle to understand, you know, when something happens, when Log4j happened, we all had to go struggle with where is it being used, right? So I definitely see value there in the same way that CMDB has value. I see the same challenge, which is, oh my gosh, is that hard to maintain, right? I mean, it can be true at one point in time, but the maintenance of it is incredibly challenging. I am concerned that regardless of what we think about value or challenge, it is inevitable because of the attention on provenance now of where things come from. Because of the geopolitical situation, there is attention on the provenance of the cotton in your blue jeans and on the components in your semiconductor. So I think to a degree, it's inevitable that we're going to have to give it attention. And I think it's going to be a challenge.
Yeah, I think, I mean, I couldn't agree with you more. I mean, I think from a Nirvana perspective, would I love to have a software bill of materials? Absolutely. I would be happy right now with CMDB that actually has the representative inventory. I mean, this is super hard. And we've been playing with some technologies and they're super cool ideas. They do application mapping. They'll do all this stuff. They'll spit out an inventory. And then 5 minutes later, it's no longer valid. So, you know, like I get it academically and I will, by heaven, I will work for it, but please tell me, show me how to do it. Like I practically speaking, I just don't know how to do it.
I love that. I love that, Kris. And you know, all of you have just kind of shared, I think, the long tail problem we've had in security for the longest time on just inventory with it. And most of that was hardware and devices. And we could hardly get our arms around something we could see and touch and feel. And now we've got something that we cannot see or touch or feel. And we're going to try to like recreate this perfect world of I got it all covered and every library I've used is referenceable and authentic. And so I feel like the objective is noble, but the execution is near impossible. And once again, the CISO's mission is going to be to go figure it out, go fix it.
I'm trying to push it on the product units. Does that count? I'll let you know if I'm successful.
We try to push the inventory problem to the help desk and to other, yeah, you know, infrastructure teams. It didn't work.
It didn't work. I know. I couldn't agree more. And I, not to get too, you know, meta about this whole thing, but I still feel like we're trying to use physical concepts in a world where that doesn't mean anything anymore.
Yeah. Absolutely. Absolutely.
We're doing the same thing with hybrid work. We're trying to use old concepts and figure it out now, and we need to think different.
Yeah, right. So, you know, so whether you develop your own software and you want this bill of materials, or whether you buy software that comes to you in a black box and you just kind of, you know, plug it in and it works, you know, what do you all as security leaders want the designers of these software components to know? What do you want them to know about security and what's going to allow you to help them?
You know, I would like to know people who are making things, making software, I'd like to say, you know, what's your threat modeling approach and how do you threat model and mitigate for it? Probably the first question is, do you know what the words threat modeling, when strung together, even mean? I don't feel like there is the transparency around that fact. You know, when you look at a hotel room to rent or a house to buy, you're going to look at how good are the locks on the doors. And the seller wouldn't expect you to do anything different, right? We don't really talk about that yet in products. And that seems like we're willfully not acknowledging a huge characteristic of the stuff that powers the world around us now.
Yep. And what do you want your software suppliers, what do you want them to know in order to earn your trust?
I want them to admit they're not perfect. How's that? That'll go a long way toward trust. Sorry, that's probably not a productive answer.
So how do they earn your trust, Rinki? The Microsofts, the Apples, you know, the Salesforces. What do you want them to know to earn your trust?
I mean, I think it's really important for them to understand what kind of I want them to care as much as we do about our own business, right? And what kind of customers we serve and what that would mean for them. That's one. But I think it also comes down, I mean, a lot of the business, we tried to apply science to supplier chain security, but there's a little bit of art, I would say a little bit more to it. And at the end of the day, it's about the people too. And, you know, we've had significant, like all of us have dealt with issues with suppliers where we've had significant issues. And at the end of the day, how they handle that, how they work with you on that, how much they care, I think it boils down to a lot of that and the team that you're working with. But I think it comes down to them showcasing like them understanding your business and how they're building safety and security into what they're building. And I think that's the one thing I could say. It's a tough question, Shamla.
Well, maybe after you had a couple glasses of wine, you should write that down and we can tell them. Okay, I'm gonna go take some questions in the Q&A. So thank you everyone for writing so prolifically. Paul said, you know, the software bill of materials is a game changer. And even though it's a long way off from a process that enables sharing those outputs, both upstream or downstream, that can be consistently validated, you know, what are your thoughts on that? Because it's a great idea in theory. I think we've already said that. But, you know, that consistent validation is now going to leave us with one opportunity for a gap, right? Some auditor is going to say, you didn't validate this. So any thoughts from the panel on?
You know, one thing, and I don't know how many of y'all, I'm actually interested, how many of y'all in your organizations are talking about this. The further down the road we go toward needing to attest to things like SBOM, or even more disclosure around incidents and the data and forensics around incidents, we're going to need to have systems and that are auditable and single sources of truth like SOCs. You know, SOCs led to the need for businesses to have these very well-controlled systems of record for audit purposes. We're not designed that way right now in software development or in cyber. And I'm not sure that that's a piece that we're really thinking about yet, but it's going to be a logical tail to this increase in regulations. And that is going to be really challenging.
Yeah, Shamla, can I, you know, as I'm listening to all the conversation, I think, you know, there is something that I've been running into that I think is important, which is this issue. And I mentioned in the beginning, which is complexity. You know, oftentimes, so we do a lot of minimum viable business identification and planning with customers. We go forth and we say, all right, what do you care about? Like, how do you, what is the business service? How long do you want? How, what are the RTO? You know, what are the components? Who are the supply chain partners? Great. Oftentimes, at the end of the day, we come up with the business, and then the customer will say, well, we want you to make this resilient. We want you to vault it. We want you to vault all the configurations. We want you to vault the data. And my answer to them is, God himself or herself could not make this thing resilient. The only way you're going to make this resilient is to rebuild these applications, get off of this legacy infrastructure, simplify the number of supply chain partners you have, because you don't have the expertise, you don't have the technology controls, you don't have the visibility, you just got too much stuff. And so one of the I think in order for us to get anywhere, resilience, security, it's a, we have to really fundamentally rethink kind of the underlying infrastructure on which our services are built. You know, for a very long time, we've built up this legacy infrastructure. We've moved these workloads to cloud, we wrappered some stuff on top of it. We got to bring it back, right? So I'd say one of the best things that a CISO or a security person can do on this phone is to not think about it as a security person, but think about it as a business person. Is the right answer to spend more on security, or is the right answer to spend more on refactoring your applications so that you can get to a more simple environment so that something like an SBOM is actually possible? But going back to Joanna's point, if you can't think the same way, I'm sorry, a lot of the legacy stuff we've got today, it is not possible for us to get to the goals that we're establishing for ourselves.
So I think we acknowledged Wayne's concern, which the problem with the SBOM is that the information and the risks change monthly. So I think we're acknowledging that. There is one other suggestion, and I feel like I know where this panel might go on this, is Raj asked the question, do you feel there needs to be more prescription versus just guidance? Right now, there seems to be more suggestions versus prescription. And will that change anything? That last part is my add to the question, but what do you all think? Prescription?
It feels like we're going that way because the guidelines haven't quite worked yet. And I mean, that it makes sense. We've seen that play out in aviation safety. We see it play out in road transportation. You see that play out around anything that requires protection or safety or defense. So, you know, I would say it's human nature. I think it's true. I also don't think it's unique to cybersecurity.
So I would love to take what Kris said and just make that a prescription.
I'm in. I love it. I could not agree more with that. That's the sort of thing that needs to be cross-stitched on a pillow, which is quit investing millions in security and just rebuild your stuff.
Yep, that's gonna be a whole new leadership role. I can see that happen. Okay, let's take a couple more questions. So, we talked a little bit about this already. Is there a role for the federal government to help the private sector in improving supply chain security? I mean, they haven't been able to help us on every other angle yet. I'm not sure why we would rely on them, but okay, that may be a unique position. Let my expert panel tell me that I'm getting it wrong.
Can I make trying to solve the problem, but thinking a different way? One of the biggest problems with critical infrastructure is not necessarily security. It's the way in which we budget for critical infrastructure. So if you take a utility as an example, the way they budget is they have like a 3-year rate case with the state, as an example. And they build a plan, a capital plan. They're going to acquire capital. They're going to build the security control in and around the technology, and it's going to last 3 years, right? That's what the budget is. The budget's going to last 3 years. 3 years from now, I can start planning and I can come back for more. How quickly does security change? How quickly do you have to make determinations about where the budget is going to be applied? Until we change the budgeting, we're not going to be able to change how we approach security within the critical infrastructure for at least large swaths of the critical infrastructure. So again, we're talking about the right problem. We're talking about solving it in the wrong way. So just want to put that one out there.
Love it. Love it. Okay. So Lynn makes a point, and I love to hear your perspective. I think there's two questions about this, which is the licensing of software. Lynn's talking about the licensing of software developers and a potential solution on credentialing the software developer. And then someone else asked about licensing the actual software and open source and the fact that, you know, some business leaders might like the idea that open source seems free, but do they understand that it's not really free and that there may be a whole bunch of other challenges that come with open source? So should we credential developers?
You know, we started credentialing network engineers. And, you know, I'm curious, do y'all think that was that good? Did it make a difference? My opinion is I think overall it was good. You know, it exposed a lot of the people who are actually standing up and running networks to concepts that they might not have run into in their daily job. I feel like this is one of those things you can argue the pros and cons of, right? And like anything about certifications, you can always argue that it's a moneymaker for the people who do it, or it's this great benefit and exposes you to all this knowledge. I would like to see us start with discussing that part of software development training should be security concept. I'd love to start there. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't think we need to jump to certification. I'd like to see universities and apprenticeship programs that teach development, weave this into how we teach development. And that's not happening holistically yet.
Yep. Okay, we have a couple other quick questions. So Sean asked, almost all companies rely on cloud providers. How do you justify the risk associated with those providers? You know, for instance, you know, you've got some big cloud provider that goes offline for, you know, some period of time. Is that acceptable risk to the supply chain? How do you manage that? And I think, Kris, you talked earlier about if you cannot measure it, you cannot approve it. So who's approving all these risks?
I can say, because, you know, we're monitoring so many different infrastructures across so many different platforms. You know, the problem is between the seams. And let me try to explain. It's never what I wish you could say, oh yeah, it's the cloud provider that's the risk. It's not necessarily the cloud provider that's the risk. It's the how did you sort of marry the underlying infrastructure to the application and then back into your environment? Was it AD that got corrupted? Was it a system? What we see a lot, it's a data corruption issue between the application, the provider, and then, you know, some, there's like some storage system somewhere. It's in sort of the interaction between those components. So I would say I'm not sure it's as simple as saying that the cloud provider provides is the risk. The issue is the complexity of the system hosted within the infrastructure, no matter what that infrastructure is.
And I'm going to make an intentionally provocative statement that a lot of cloud usage I consider less risk than on-premise legacy systems. And, you know, a lot of the reason that I am a fan of a lot of cloud usage in the right spaces is that you can automate the oversight and the visibility. It's really hard to automate oversight and visibility on on-prem systems. So I'm not going to say that one's right and one's wrong. I think they both have their place. But I would not necessarily say that utilizing the cloud brings more risk in. Mm-hmm.
And it should be managed like any other component in the ecosystem, right?
Yep. It can be huge risk if it's not managed right, like Kris said.
Yep. Yeah. Or if you don't refactor your application, you just plunk a legacy app
just
on top of a cloud.
And shift something into the cloud. Yeah, and then you're not going to save any money either, which is a different topic. Yeah.
Right. Yes. Yes. So we have two questions that are around data and data management, or data protection and data management practices. So, you know, how do you monitor vendors for those kinds of data management practices? And, you know, do you have any like great ideas that people might want to consider?
I think it's important to have, I mentioned this earlier, I think it's important to have a data map. And we talked about this similar to CMDB and similar to SBOM. You have to make sure those data maps are kept updated. There is new innovation in this space that's actually been super impressive that I've seen, where you can automate and there's tools that can help you detect what kind of vendors you're connected to, what data you're sharing, alert you on kind of if there's things that are against your policy or against requirements in your environment. So there's a lot that you can do. I think we're seeing, again, questions around, question on where this team sits, but you're seeing more and more like requirements around data deletion and data retention and all of that. And I think there's more and more companies forming data governance teams or a data strategy team. Sometimes that's within a CISO, sometimes it's not. But then partnering with legal and privacy and security to think about all those elements. And I think there can be a lot of automation that's built in your environment that helps you see that data sprawl.
Hey, one thing to be careful of, though, you know, is there are a lot of vendors out there today that do sort of scorecards on supply chain partners. So just, you know, I think that there's value in to an extent in what it is that they're doing. And we use them, we sell them to and deliver those services to our customers. But I always suggest that there's a caveat here, which is at the end of the day, you gotta, whoever's being measured, you know, often like I've run into some cases where they looked at us and they gave us a, you know, sort of a negative score. It turns out we had a bunch of honeypots out there. So they're grabbing our honeypots and then they're scoring us negatively because we got honeypots. Come on, guys, give me a break. You know, this, that doesn't work. So I'd say there's a, when it comes to, you know, sort of these scorecards, be very, very, very careful about the metrics that they're gathering and what they're producing for you. Be thoughtful and circumspect because you may be saying this particular institution is okay. This one is not, when it should be the flip. It should be the reverse. So just be super careful.
Yep. And you know, and you, one thing I just want to remind, I think, you know, the audience here is we talked a little bit about cloud, and very often the cloud infrastructure will be way more secure than you could build it yourself, simply because they have specialization, they have resources, they're building this, you know, at an industrial scale. So we might get a lot of security from cloud services. The other thing is it accelerates everything else you do. There's no question, right, that if you can just turn up infrastructure, you can start building capability very quickly. The thing, your data is your responsibility, never the cloud provider's responsibility. It's your data. You need to make sure that you take appropriate steps to protect and secure the data, even if the infrastructure is safe and secure.
I'm a huge, the people that work with me get really tired of my car analogies. I'm a huge car analogy person. But you know, you can buy a car. The way you drive it is not the car manufacturer's problem. Mm-hmm. Now, they need to build their stuff right. And, you know, it absolutely needs to have the features that you need, and it needs to have the safety guardrails. But a lot of it is up to the user to make sure that they use them properly.
Yep. So given all of this, I'd be remiss to not ask about the elephant in the room. So, you know, you get your box of software or your download link or whatever it is, it's a black box. You install it, you configure it, you make it work. And that seems to be a pretty big challenge in the software supply chain. We've talked about it. I think we all would agree there's some risks in that, and it takes a lot of work. Now you add into that these large language models and other AI models that will impact the software supply chain. Now you don't know where that library came from. You don't really know what's inside. What are you all thinking about the software supply chain risk with respect to these new technologies and innovations?
I think there's a lot of similarity there to what we were just talking about with cloud, which is none of these models can absolve the user or absolve the consumer of appropriate usage of them. And there is, it's interesting, if you sit and read the T's and C's with some of the various GAI models out there right now, those T's and C's are pretty thorough in saying, here's the risk you're taking, here's what we expect you to do, and, right? Now, who reads T's and C's? You know, who reads EULAs, right? But there's a lot in there, I think, that we, especially as practitioners and the governors of policy at enterprises, need to take into account to help guide people on how to use these things appropriately. And I don't think there's going to be one size fits all answers. You know, we know financial service institutions are going to struggle with this because they can't describe the model. That's going to preclude use in some cases. Okay. You know, other verticals won't struggle with that so much. So there's no easy button in life. And I don't think that GAI brings any easy buttons with it either. It's just different.
Yeah, I was going to say, I think that it's an interesting question, and it's sort of like what Rinki was describing, but in reverse, in so much as, you know, I think we're going to be beginning to procure large corpuses of data and training our own models. And then the question becomes, can I trust the integrity of the data that I'm procuring from that third party? Has that third party protected the data in such a way that I can rely on the integrity of that data? So, an issue I was working on, this is about 2 years back, but it was a company that was crunching data from weather satellites and then providing that data to emergency responders. But what was happening is the corpus of data itself was being tampered with so that the outcomes and the suggestions being given to emergency responders were wrong, right? Sending people to the wrong place at the wrong time to deal with the wrong issue. Now, we've got it. That's a particularly egregious case, but let's be realistic. You know, we're training these algorithms based on this massive amount of data, and it is going to be very hard for you to unroll your algorithms once you've trained them, because you don't know which features trained what. It's very hard to do. So you got to really, really, really trust the data. And this is going to, this is just from a short-term perspective, going to require us to think not about just privacy, because most of our T's and C's are in and around the protection of privacy, protection of intellectual secrets. We don't think about integrity. So integrity has to be the new element or new aspect. If we are going to be relying on T's and C's, you know, et cetera, we're going to have to make sure that those are factored into our thinking from a supply chain perspective.
Perfect. Okay, we're coming up to our time. But I do want to, so Daniel asked a question about how your organizations are structured with respect to management of third parties. And if you could just spend, you know, 10 seconds, just kind of, does it report to you? Does it report to the CISO? Like, what's that organization structure? And then I have one last question.
Super fast answer. I have a GRC pillar, governance, risk management, compliance. Third party governance and assessment sits in there. And then we have gates stood up in internal procurement to enforce that the checks have happened as much as we can across the enterprise. We also have a business information security officer in the supply chain pillar who works really closely with us.
Yeah, mine is set up similarly. I have a governance risk compliance team as well, and I have a third party risk management team that assesses security risk and then works closely with our procurement team. And then we have a lot that's around total third party risk. Total third party management is initiated with the procurement organization, and there's elements of InfoSec in my team, legal, and other teams that will plug in.
So our model is a little different in so much as I look after commercial security. We have a CISO who is really a second line CISO. I'm more of the first line to him. And so what my team does is we're providing a lot of the active testing of supply chain partners as they're coming into the pipe. So what we'll do is we sort of will help ensure the standards are adhered to from a DevSecOps perspective. We'll actually do the active testing. If we have a vendor that's going to come in, we're going to begin to provide it to the clients. My team actually kicks that technology around, does all of the active pen testing, et cetera. So we're more of a service provider to our CISO, who's more of a customer.
Fantastic. Thank you for sharing that. So last question. As people walk away from this particular session, what is one practical thing you want them to go do? What is one must do?
I think I mentioned this. Oh yeah, I think I mentioned this earlier, that ensuring that the critical third parties that you rely on, that you have a good BCPDR plan associated with it, that you have secondary vendor even considered in case that company goes down for whatever reason, whether it's a service availability or cybersecurity breach. I think that's the most important thing in my career over the companies that I've worked at. Having that secondary backup plan, the recovery plan, has been invaluable. So that would be my biggest feedback.
Joanna? I'm going to add on to that and say, have it and test it. Exercise your resilience.
So Joanna stole mine, but my last one would be ensure that you are thinking, you've got eyes wide open when it comes to sort of assessing the criticality of those partners. Really go back and talk to your procurement organization and get a sense of how do they rank? How do they determine who's critical and who's not? And if you can sort of emphasize the need to really be thinking about what is the technology that they are building or providing on your behalf, to what extent am I relying on it? What happens if it goes down? Because that may change the way in which you sort of manage that relationship.
And I would just make, just to summarize this, I think you heard there's a lot of skill, there's a lot of experience, there's a lot we do today, there's a lot we need to think about doing in the future to make this a more successful kind of area of practice for security leaders. I would say there's technology, you heard there's inspection, you heard about, inventory and risk rating and ranking, et cetera. I would add that we shouldn't forget on the other side of all these practices are humans. Make sure that we include them in the ecosystem as we're beginning to build trust. And with that, I want to thank my esteemed panel. You all did such a great job and shared so much information for everyone who's attended. I thank you all for contributing your knowledge to the session.
And I echo that. Thank you so much, Joanna, Rinki, and Kris, for joining us. Shamla, great job moderating that panel. Attendees, we will be back in a few minutes, right at the bottom of the hour, to regroup and deliver the sessions from Felix and Joseph and Jen. So thank you all so much.